Hello. In this episode, we're going to be looking at arrays and lists, which are both ways of storing a collection of variables of the same type. Let's start with arrays. Imagine we want to store a number of different names. Instead of creating a new variable for each one, string name 1 equals Fred, string name 2 equals George, and so on, we can rather create just one string array variable, which we do just like creating a normal variable, except that after the type, we place a pair of square brackets. If we want, we can directly assign a collection of values to the array by having a pair of curly brackets inside which are all the elements separated by commas. Somewhere in our code, we can now access any element in the array by writing the array's name, so in this case possible names, followed by a pair of square brackets inside which goes the index of the element we wish to access. Now, there are four elements in this particular array, but arrays are indexed starting at 0, meaning that the first element in the array has an index of 0, the second has an index of 1, and so on. So if we try and access index 4 or greater, we will get an index out of bounds exception. Now, let's say we want to pick a random name from this array for our character. The first step would be to generate a random number between 0 and 3. So if we're working in Unity, we can simply use the random.range method and pass in 0 as our min value and possible names.length as our max value. The length of our array is 4, but remember that the random.range method returns a value that is greater than or equal to the minimum value and less than the max value, which means that we're actually getting a value between 0 and 3 like we want. So now that we have our random index, we can simply write string character name is equal to possible names with an index of random name index. Okay, let's look at another example. This time I'll create an array of integers, which I'll call powers of 2. Say we just want to store the first 5. Well, we've already seen one way of assigning these, so let's look at another. We can set the array equal to a new integer array with a size of 5, at which point all 5 elements in the array will be equal to 0, since that's the default integer value. Somewhere in our code, we can then write powers of 2 with an index of 0 equals 2, powers of 2 with an index of 1 equals 4, and so on. Much smarter, of course, would be to use a loop to initialize all of these, and we'll be seeing an example of this in the next episode, which is on loops. Note that we could also leave the initialization out at the top here, but then we'd still have to define the array's size before we can use it. Once we've initialized the array's size, we cannot change it, except by setting the variable equal to a new array with a new size, which of course will destroy all the elements currently stored inside the array. Now, arrays don't have to have just a single dimension. Say we want a two-dimensional integer array to keep track of the pieces in some board game, for example. The syntax for this would be like so. The size of each dimension is separated by a comma, so here I've created a 3x3 board. A single comma is also placed between the square brackets at the declaration, indicating that there is space for two dimensions. We can now visualize this array as looking like so, with all elements currently initialized to their default value of 0. The indices work how you'd probably expect, with the first index determining the row and the second index determining the column. So, in some method, if we wanted to set the value of the bottom left square to 1, for example, that would be as simple as writing board with an index of 2, 0 is equal to 1. Now, perhaps the game requires a starting configuration of pieces, with different pieces obviously represented by different numbers. Well, the syntax for this is the same as a one-dimensional array, but now the entries for each new row are surrounded by curly brackets as well. To make this easier to read, we could separate each row onto a new line, which gives us a nice visual representation of the array. You're not limited to just two dimensions, by the way. For more dimensions, simply add more commas. Alright, let's now take a look at lists. Say we want to do something like keep track of the names of every character that our player kills, so that we can display them all at the end of the game. We might think to make a string array called something like slain enemy names, but unlike in the previous examples, the size of the array is uncertain because we don't know how many enemies the player will end up killing. To solve this problem, we can make use of the list class, which is in the system.collections.generic namespace. Now, to create a list of strings, we write list, followed by the type string inside angle brackets. We then, of course, have the variable identifier, in other words, its name, and we can initialize this to a new empty list. Take note of the syntax for this. We have the new keyword, followed by list of type string, and then a pair of parentheses to call the constructor of the list class. Say we now have an onEnemyKilled method, which supplies us with the name of the enemy. We can add this name to the end of the list using the list's add method, so slainEnemyNames.add, and pass in the supplied name. Accessing a certain element from a list uses the same syntax as with arrays, just the variable name followed by square brackets with the index inside. Just like arrays, lists are indexed starting at 0. Recall that to get the size of an array, we could use the length property. You can keep track of the number of elements inside a list using the count property. Lists also have some other functionality that mere arrays do not. For example, you can use the remove method to remove a given element from the list. You can also use the contains method to check if the list already contains a given element. And there's even a sort method, so if you have a list of numbers, calling sort will cause them to be arranged in ascending order. And if you have a list of strings, they can then be sorted alphabetically. We'll even look later at how you can instruct the sort method to follow your own custom sorting rules. So, since lists can do everything arrays can do, as well as change size, and they have these helpful methods for things like searching and sorting, you may be left wondering why we even need arrays. Well, I think it's important to know that behind the scenes, a list is actually storing everything inside an array. Whenever the internal array gets filled up, the list has to create a new, bigger array and copy all the existing elements over into that new array. Purely for interest's sake, on screen at the moment, you can see a heavily simplified version of the list class, just demonstrating how the array is resized as new items are added. So, in general, arrays are slightly faster than lists, although in most cases, this difference is negligible. The real reason you might sometimes want to use an array instead of a list is if the collection should logically have a fixed size, for example, representing a game board or storing the items in a player's inventory. In these cases, the concept of adding an item doesn't really make much sense. You only ever want to insert an item at a specific index. I should mention that it's entirely possible to have a list of arrays, or an array of lists, or a list of lists, or an array of arrays, or pretty much any configuration you can imagine. I should also mention that arrays and lists are reference types. So if I have an empty integer array, say with a size of 5, and I now create a second array and set it equal to the first array, then if I set one of the elements to 99 and print out the value of that element in the other array, we'll see that it also now has a value of 99. If this seems strange to you, please go back and watch episode 17 on reference types and value types. Anyway, to recap, arrays are for storing collections of a fixed size and can have one or more dimensions. Lists are slightly slower than arrays, but are able to resize themselves dynamically as you add and remove elements, and also provide some helpful methods such as contains and sort. Finally, arrays and lists are both reference types and are indexed starting at 0. That's everything for this video. Until next time, cheers!